Good morning and welcome to this virtual meeting of Baroda Book Browsers. And I hope all of you and your family members are taking enough care to stay safe and healthy in the midst of ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. Today's book, Jugalbandi, The BJP Before Modi, is a very recent book. Only last year it was published. And the fact that the subtitle of this book is BJP Before Modi in itself speaks volumes of the popularity of the current leader and Prime Minister of India. Although the book essentially talks about how in last nearly 100 years since BJP in its earlier form as Hindu Mahasabha came into being in 1925, the author takes us in initial chapter through to the fledgling, nascent, struggling period of BJP, as it is known now, then Hindu Mahasabha. It took quite a while, you know, before they established their footing. And I would say even in post-independence India, Janasangh, as it was known, BJP then, was constantly struggling to establish a toehold in Indian polity. At least till 1980. In fact, in 1984, the party won only 2 seats. But be that as it may, but its real meteoric rise came in 1992 after Rama Janmabhoomi and following the Pan India Rath Yatra undertaken by one of the most important leaders of BJP, Lal Krishna Advani. This book essentially is about, you know, how in tandem Lal Krishna Advani and Atal Bihari Vajpayee operated, struggled, nurtured, and built the foundation pillars of BJP, which is now currently the most dominant party of India. And like in any Jugalbandi, you know, a musical concert wherein, you know, the two major players with different instruments, they complement each other. The author throughout has been saying in this book that they have complemented each other while building founding pillars of this party. So that is about the book, and I'm sure Rajiv, who is going to review this book today, will talk about also the author, Vinay Sitapati, who has got impressive credentials. He's an assistant professor in political science at Ashoka University in Delhi. Rajiv, of course, is an engineer by profession and works as the chief operating officer for the refrigerant business of a very well-known company, Gujarat Fluorochemicals Limited. He is an avid reader, and he follows very closely and is quite interested in the Indian politics and, you know, the allied matters. He is an active member of Baroda Book Browsers. He has already reviewed 3 books in the past, one by Ramchandra Guha, Making of Modern India. Then the other book he reviewed recently was Choices by Shiv Shankar Menon. And also of the same author, he reviewed a book, How P.V. Narasimha Rao Transformed India, or Half Lion. So that is for the antecedents of, you know, Rajiv Jain. Without further ado, I would now like to invite Rajiv to carry out his presentation of this book. But before that, let me remind the attendees, during the course of, you know, the review, as and when you have some points or some posers to raise, please feel free to enter your questions and your points of view in the chats, which is at the top end corner of the screen. You may be able to see that. And after the review is over, those questions and your points of view will be considered. With this remark, over to you, Rajiv, next 45 minutes for carrying out this book review. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Sambhavi, I'm visible and audible?
You are.
Okay.
Please go ahead.
Can we see the presentation? The screen is visible?
Yes, yes, please go ahead.
Okay, right. So the book title, thank you, Sunil Bhai, for inviting me, for giving this opportunity to present my fourth book in Baroda Book Browser. The book title is Jugalbandi, The BJP Before Modi. Author is Vinay Sethupathi. This book was released in November 2020 and is a very recent book. So it's a Jugalbandi of Atal Bihari Vajpayee and Lal Krishna Advani, who were the founder member of Bharatiya Janata Party. Here you see the two photos. This is one. And this is the second. Actually, this one is the original photo, showing two person in contrast. I reviewed another book by Vinay Sethupathi in 2017, Half Lion, How P.V. Narasimha Rao Transformed India. That book was very popular and published in many languages. This book published by Random House, year 310 pages of book, 83 pages of footnotes, 1800 footnotes from various magazines, books and interviews. It's very remarkable for each and every sentence, for each and every paragraph, there is a reference. Since author is an advocate, so he made sure that whatever he is presenting is authentic and has some backing. He took 200 interviews of various politicians, writers, journalists from different fields associated with the Jansangh, RSS, BJP and all. He has been invited by all reputed TV channels, independent channels, Wire and many for discussion on this book. Took 3 years to write the book. He says the writing the book is a serious business and it's a very, very boring business. You have to read, go through the article several times and several articles. So it's a very tough business. He took 1 year leave from Ashoka University. After writing the book on P.V. Narasimha Rao, he wanted to write biography of Atal Bihari Vajpayee. But he thought it would be only half the story without Lal Krishna Advani. So he wrote this book, Jugalbandi, which is basically a story of Atal Bihari Vajpayee and Advani's friendship. Some background of the book. The author is 37 years old, grew up in Mumbai in early 90s. So in early 90s, he saw two major things happening in India. That McDonald's is opening in Mumbai and people queuing up to buy burger. So he saw liberalization is taking place, and at the same time, BJP is rising. And both the events, they didn't just happen. There is a political story behind it. So for liberalization.
Mr. Rajiv, sorry to interrupt. It seems your files are not being shared on the screen. So just hold for a while. Try. Your slides are not moving, on the screen.
Not moving.
Yeah, not moving. Just try to see that. It's a static slide, the first one only.
Just a minute. Oh, come on. Is it moving now? Hello? No.
No, it is not. It is not moving.
Okay.
So you can follow the process of screen sharing all over again. It'll show then.
Okay. Is it moving? Hello?
Yeah, it is now moving. Yeah, it is moving.
It is moving. So I put it on the select show.
Show mode, yes.
Yeah. Is it moving now?
Yes, it is. Please go ahead.
Okay. Right. Thank you. Thank you. Sorry. So I was here, introduction. So what I was telling that when Sitapati grew up in early 90s, he saw two things happening in India during that time. Liberalization, India's economy is opening up, and rise of BJP. And he thought that they are not just happening. There is a political story behind it. On liberalization, he wrote the book Half Lion, How PB Narasimha Rao Transformed India. And BJP was also rising. So and now BJP is much stronger and dominant political party in India. And he saw the Modi's success. It did just not happen. There is a 100 years history behind it. So this book is 100 years political history through Jugalbandi of Patel, Bihari Vajpayee and Lal Krishna Advani as why BJP wins. Book starts in 1924 and ends in 2004. So it is before rise of Narendra Modi and Amit Shah's Jugalbandi. Jugalbandi is a Hindi word. It is typically used for musical concerts where two musicians use different instruments to make music together, and both are equally important. No one is above one, and both have equal standing. Like Sitapati's other books, it is very well formatted, chronically arranged, and the entire book is divided into four parts. Part one, the past six chapters, 1924 to 1980, how the Hindu nationalism shaped. Second is the party, five chapters from 1980 when BJP was formed until 1998, just before they assumed power at the center. The part three is power, five chapters, 1994, 1998 to 2004. And part four is 2004 and after, where they describe the recent Jugalbandi of Modi and this thing. Can you read it? Wristwatch. The three main characters, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Lal Krishna Advani, and Narendra Modi. Part one, the past, 1924 to 1980. According to the author, the secret source of BJP's win in is Hindu majority. An author called it Hindu. This chapter describes the birth, education, and upbringing of Vajpayee and Advani. They born and brought up in a totally different background.
Are you moving the slide or you are still on slide number three only?
No, I'm moving the slide.
No, it's not moving here.
Moving the slide. Continuously I'm moving the slide.
No, it's not moving.
See that?
Yeah, now it is moved. Now it is moved, yeah. Okay, please go ahead. Yeah. Okay, you are now on part one, Hindu
family.
Hindu family.
So this chapter chapter describes the upbringing of Bajpayee and Lal Krishna Advani, but they born and brought up in a totally different circumstances. Bajpayee was born in Gwalior in a middle class Brahmin family. Advani was born in Karachi in a syncretic family, very rich family, where his house has got a horse-drawn carriage and separate game room. And he spoke English and Sindhi before he spoke Hindi. During that time, Hindu identity was shaping up. There is a very wide definition of Hindu as a Hinduism, because Hindu identity lacks the canonical book like Quran in Islam, and institution like Vatican in Christianity. So Hindu's definition is very wide and all. It's very difficult to describe exactly what is Hindu and what is Hinduism. So since this book starts in 1924, so now there is a political history comes into picture. Hindu Mahasabha and Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh formed in 1923. Hindu Mahasabha was a political party for electoral unity, and RSS was a social organization who didn't participate in the election. And Hindu Mahasabha and couple of other political parties where British introduced the election on the large scale. And Hindu Mahasabha, there was another party called Ram Raj Party and all. They saw that we can brought the Hindu together through electoral unity. And they call it Hindu Fevicol. Both Bajpayee and Advani joined RSS in different time and in different circumstances. And the basic part of describing this is the one, because RSS is a family like institute and which emphasizes on teamwork, and this shaped their six decades partnership. So that is a very important point. Now this screen is moving, Sunil bhai.
No, it is on Fevicol only, it is not moving.
That's a problem. Can you see now? I think I have to go on.
Now the new slide is. So you'll have to keep looking at it. Yeah, please do that.
Yeah, okay, right. So
now it is part is the, one. Please go
ghost
ahead.
Ghost of partition. Ghost of partition. So ghost of partition is 1945 to 50. Okay. So partition affected Advani and Bajpayee in a different way. Bajpayee didn't affect much because he was in the central part of India. It affected Advani in a very large scale. His entire family moved, and from a very rich person, he became a very poor person and moved in 1948 to India. Now, though Hindu Mahasabha was formed, but in 1945 elections, Congress was still a sole representative of Hindus and the Muslim League of Muslims, and Hindu Mahasabha got totally defeated. So what we see is a different Hindu majority, Hindu vote bank and Muslim vote banks are getting formed. RSS continued as a non-political social organization. Now this the thing they describe how Bajpayee and Advani moved in the organization. Bajpayee was has been a fantastic communicator. He joined as a communicator and became editor of Panchajanya, fantastic Hindi and very good orator. RSS perceived once Pakistan has moved along with the Muslim, and they perceived as a sole representative of Hindus. And it was happening, but Gandhi's assassination led to banning of RSS and his widespread opposition. And that opposition was so much, it took almost two decades to bring RSS on its feet again. Okay, next chapter is in Nehru's shadow, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. Uh, Janasangh formed by Mukherjee. Most of the people came from RSS, and when Golwalkar transferred 5%, they call it gold pieces. Deen Dayal Upadhyay, he played a very important role in Bharat Janasangh. Sundar Singh Bhandari, Nanaji Deshmukh, B.S. Soni, and Balraj Madho. Though they were the founder member of Bharatiya Janasangh. So Advani and Vajpayee's Jugalbandi is not first. First Jugalbandi was of Deen Dayal Upadhyay and Mukherjee. Mukherjee was a face in the parliament, and Deen Dayal Upadhyay as a organizer, cadre man. During that time, Janasangh was still operated under Nehru's shadow. First time Vajpayee and Advani met in during campaign of 1951-52 first election, and their friendship started and continued until Vajpayee died. Vajpayee become assistant of Mukherjee and Advani in given organization. Vajpayee become Lok Sabha member, first time became Lok Sabha member in 1957, and he remained in the parliament, whether Lok Sabha and Raj Sabha, until 2009. So he was basically a parliament man. And there, because of Jugalbandi, there has to be a very good chemistry among the two people. So they used to live together. They almost used to talk to each other, meet with each other, and used to watch movies and eat pani puri together. So thing is, that is a another chemistry. Unless you like each other, that the Jugalbandi cannot be formed. Vajpayee's oratory skill impressed all, and Nehru called him future prime minister. There is one small incident where he introduced Vajpayee as future prime minister in front of the Khrushchev. Khrushchev told, if suppose he is a future prime minister, what he is doing here? In Russia, we would have sent this person to Gulag. Gulag is a prison. So this shows the strength of the parliament and democracy in India. Vajpayee didn't have very good relations with RSS, and there is an incident of Rajkumari, his relation with Rajkumari Kohl, which RSS didn't like. Partnership forced by fire. So how this Vajpayee and Advani's partnership is getting formed, and how they are coming close to each other in a very, very good terms. So Vajpayee rose in Janasangh after demise of Deen Dayal Upadhyay, who was found dead in 1968. And another competitor was Balraj Madho. He supplanted Balraj Madho and he's become successor. Vajpayee, there was no change in economic policies and all. Vajpayee supported Indira's, initially Nehru's economic policy, and later Indira's economic policies. Advani also joined Raj Sabha. So Bharatiya Janasangh diluted his ideology to win elections until 2002. So there was another shift after Modi came in being. So for several decades, Modi, Vajpayee and Advani had a full control on party until Modi and Amit Shah's Jugalbandi took over. So that is right from 1968 to 2004. Initially, RSS, when Golwalkar was head, they didn't participate in any, they didn't support any political party, and then didn't took part in any political activities. But after his demise, they became more realistic and realized the importance of political calculations. Paksha prison, 1974 to 1977. During emergency, both were put in jail together, where Vajpayee used to cook. This has created intimacy between them. So author is describing how that Jugalbandi is being formed and become very intimate. Now there is an introduction of Narendra Modi, who joined RSA during that time, and during emergency he worked underground and expanded his horizon. He used to place and He used to communicate with various Jansang and RSS members.
Rajiv, are you switching? Are you flipping the slide or still on?
Part one, Paxo Prison. This is the slide I'm showing now. Can you see
okay,
that?
Okay, fine. Yeah, part one. Yeah, prison.
1974 to 77. Yeah.
Okay, fine. That's fine. That's fine.
Okay. So during 1977, Janata Party formed, and Jansang was still moderate phase, and they aligned with other party under Jay Prakash Narayan. So they were become the was part of the government as Janata Party. So after that, there was no Jansang. So 1977 to 80, they were part of the Janata government. They didn't push any Hindutva agenda. They were only three members. There was a lot of issues about the dual membership, where other parties raised the issues of dual membership of Janata Party and Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. So because of this internal squabble, Janata government formed, and it happened in 1980, and soon after Advani announced a new party. So this is the past. Now we are entering in the second part. So first part is the past, at the formation of Raj Sabha Party Jansang, both how the Jugalbandi started, their entry into politics, became part of Janata Party, and that Janata Party ended. So there was no more Jansang and no more Janata Party. So they made another party in December 1980 and called it Bharatiya Janata Party. So there was a discussion and reviews that why, how they did not rename the party Bharatiya Jansang again. So this is part two, the party. Radical Hindus and moderate Bajpayee. So now how the party is reshaping. So BJP was formed in December 1980. Bajpayee was face of the party, first president of Bharatiya Janata Party. So author described there were so many things were happening which raised the Hindu anxiety. The Kachipuram incidents in Tamil Nadu, where Dalits were converted to Muslims. This created a lot of Hindu anxiety and rise of BHP, Vishwa Hindu Parishad. But during that time also, BJP shows its moderation, which was not liked by RSS. So this is how these relations with RSS were shaping up. During that time, another Jugalbandi was formed in 1982. Modi and Amit Shah met first time. So they are also completing almost 40 years of their Jugalbandi. And their Jodi was very famous, and they were used to call Jai Biru in region of Ahmedabad. And since Bajpayee was very moderate, so RSS didn't campaign or support BJP in various elections. At that time, this Hindu Parishad started Ayodhya Ram Temple time. Another Hindu anxiety was shaping because of many reasons. Khalistan issues was also coming up. So author is showing that Hindus were becoming anxious. And during that time, not the BJP, Congress was the first party who tried to take that advantage. And Congress party who encouraged Ayodhya movement in some time in 1986. RSS in 1984 election supported Rajiv Gandhi's Congress, not the Bharatiya Janata Party. And that's why in 1984, BJP was totally routed. Everybody knows in 1984 election, by BJP got only two seats. Even Atal Bihari Vajpayee also lost the election. And they realized, everybody told that since BJP has amended ideology, they lost. And RSS forced Bajpayee to resign, and Advani became the party president on the backlash of their defeat. And now here we see the change in BJP's ideologies. And they started raising issues like councilor ban, uniform civil code, Article 370, foreign national issues in Assam, which Bajpayee downplayed earlier. Electoral coordination with RSS resumed. So how those relations are changing? And now since initially Bajpayee was the hem of the affair, now Advani is at the top of the chart. And Bajpayee felt isolated. But again, since the author is emphasizing on Hindu unity, they squabbled, but Bajpayee never left party. And party remained united. And that is the part which the author is always emphasizing, that BJP never splits, unlike other parties, where they split again and again. And despite of all those differences, despite of their issues and all, they remain united, and then they don't air their grievances in public. So in 1989, BJP formally adopted Adhya movement 4 years after Congress did it, and this is quite significant. So two major political parties try to take the advantage of this changing in due to the rise in Hindu anxiety. And now during that time, the decline of Congress was happening. So decline of Congress happening sometime in 86-87, where initially Rajiv Gandhi's spectacular success, they started having problem. BP Singh resigned, he formed another party, and then the Congress decline started taking place, and where the BJP is coming in limelight again. And it's not only the BJP, many other parties try to take the advantage of this Hindu anxiety. Bahujan Samaj Party also took the advantage of that, of the creating a non-upper caste Hindu party. Part 2, Mandir Masjid Market, 1990 to 1991. This is a very significant year where Janata Dal government formed with the support of BJP. And the Janata Dal started having the issues. Devi Lal, Deputy Prime Minister, was removed from Janata Dal government. So he created, he organized a huge former rally, and the rally was supposed to be so big, and nobody knew how to handle that. So suddenly, Prime Minister VP Singh pulled out his magic hat, Mandal, he told that Mandal Commission's recommendations will be implemented on the reservation. And Mandal issue was such an issue that no party could oppose it, because it is all about the reservation and OBC and all. Nobody can take any stand against that. So that was the issue BJP was facing it. So they come out with a totally a different scenario, where Advani organized a Rath Yatra from Somnath to Ayodhya. And it was against the wishes of Bajpayee. Bajpayee advised him not to go for it because it will polarize the Indian society. But Advani, being a party president, he moved ahead with the Rath Yatra. And Rath Yatra was very spectacular. It met with a huge and unprecedented success. That it will make such a huge success. And it really changed the face of the political scenario in India, and that is one of the main reasons of the rise of Bharatiya Janata Party. Everybody knew Advani was arrested, BJP government fell, and the tension between Bajpayee and Advani started, but nobody had their grievances in public. And RSS, workers and all, they campaigned for BJP in 1991 election. And 91 In fact, the scenario during that time, that 91 election, BJP could have won 200 plus seats. But because of the Rajiv assassination, the sympathy went in favor of Congress, and P.V. Narasimha Rao formed a coalition government. But BJP's electoral success had started in a big way. Part two, now there is another change in scenario where from the rise there is a big decline, because in 1992 this Ayodhya movement was led by not one party. There were so many groups were there: RSS, Vishwendu Parishad, Bajrang Dal, BJP, and they all were working in a different way and forgetting the relation of lack of unity. Kalyan Singh and Murli Manohar Joshi worked in tandem with BJP against the wishes of Advani and Vajpayee. So whole Ayodhya movement was out of Ayodhya's Advani's hand. And book described that he wrote the tiger but couldn't come out. And then he didn't know what to do because the issue was totally out of hand. Babri Masjid demolished, a situation went out of control. He described in the chapter there could be a controversy, but the BJP was not responsible for that. And mostly it was mind of the people that Babri Masjid should demolish and all. But they were not directly responsible for that. Situation went out of control. That's why it had happened. But there was a backlash because of the Babri Masjid demolition. All parties getting united against BJP. And RSS went third time. First time after Mahatma Gandhi's murder, second time during emergency, and third time in 1990. Untouchable. Now there's a big decline and again change in strategy. Babri Masjid, because of the Babri Masjid, BJP government and three states dismissed. No confidence motion raised by BJP against P.V. Narasimha Rao failed because all parties united against BJP. They wanted to somehow defeat the BJP. BJP lost in MP, Rajasthan and Himachal Pradesh in 1993. So all happened because of this demolition. BJP was totally isolated. It is called a great mystery of Ayodhya movement. As long as Ayodhya movement was on, BJP was rising. The movement Babri Masjid fell down, they became isolated. But now there is again a shift in strategy. In 1995, Vajpayee announced Vajpayee as a president of party and face of electoral movement. And in state elections, they changed their strategy and raised the issues of corruption, price rise, unemployment, etc. and got good result. Advani, so Vajpayee become as a prime ministerial candidate. I think this is the first time, apart from the Congress, where opposition party announced prime ministerial candidate before the election took place. So from past to party, now in the power, and that is 1998 to 2004, and there are five chapters running parallelly. Experiment in governance, 23 party coalition form government 1998. Since it was a coalition government, BJP didn't have full majority on his own. So then they didn't pursue Article 370, Ram Temple and Uniform Civil Code. But that has always been there in mind. Somebody asked Vajpayee whether you want to implement in that. They say B, but we can't do that because we don't have the majority for that. And now again, there is a change in relation. Vajpayee is the head and Advani felt isolated. Like Vajpayee felt isolated during 90s. And Vajpayee trusted Brijesh Mishra more than Advani. And Advani really didn't play much role in the governance. Because Vajpayee thought that Advani is a very good cadre man, but he lacks competence to run the government. But again, that marriage continued. Advani felt neglected, but he didn't raise those issues in public. There is a movement now. This Amit Shah and Narendra Modi is being referred in the book again. Amit Shah wrote a letter to Vajpayee when this nuclear test took place, and he wrote against against this nuclear explosion. He said that because of your hunger for publicity, will create the problem with relation to Pakistan. Anyhow, this is what author is describing. Because of that internal democracy, one small MLA can write a letter to Prime Minister, and Prime Minister will still call him, ask for some explanation, console him, and send him back. And it might not have happened in other party during that time. I don't know. The situation is different now. So first government was in 96 for 13 days. In 1998 for 13 months. Again, 1990 election declared, and Vajpayee was all around. He was the face of the campaign and was declared the prime ministerial candidate of the BJP and NDA. So they made a coalition government. He managed allies very well. That was the one of the best strength of Vajpayee. And so the government lasted for full 5-year terms. Advani again didn't have much influence in governance. Throughout that year, during that time, RSS was uncomfortable with BJP, because issues of Hindu anxieties were not being addressed. None of the major Hindu cause was being pursued by BJP, because Vajpayee was constant with limited majority. So that is happening because of the coalition dharma. Otherwise, government would have fallen, unlike previous government during that period. Oh, Pakistan. Author described Vajpayee as the prime minister who took best efforts to improve the relations with Pakistan. And this is the unique case where none of the other prime minister took much that much efforts to improve the relations with Pakistan. He was of the belief that you can choose your relatives but not the neighbors. He took two major initiatives. First was the bus journey to Lahore from New Delhi in February 1999. Second was meeting with Parvez Musharraf in July 2001, called Agra Summit. But both the initiatives failed because they measured the centrality of Kashmir issues to Pakistan national psyche. Pakistan was very clear that unless you resolve the Kashmir issue, other things cannot be pursued between Pakistan and India. So Vajpayee didn't realize this thing, but those initiatives failed. He took a lot of initiative to improve, solve the Kashmir problem also, through his famous sentence to improve the relations through Insaniyat, Jamhuriyat, and Kashmiriyat. Advani, despite all his reservations, he supported Vajpayee. So this is how the Jugalbandi continued, where you adjust yourself with the other people. And this happened despite that Advani was displaced from Pakistan. But as per book, he didn't have any bitterness towards Pakistan. And in 2005, he went to Pakistan and wrote in the book that Jinnah was a secular person, and he did lot of things to improve the relations between Hindu and Muslims. Part 3 continued, making India great again. The period is again 1999 to 2004. Vajpayee was parliamentarian throughout his life. He saw Nehruvian consensus like state's role in economy, later India's socialism. And he took a lot of government actions to privatize PSUs. Despite of the opposition of his ministers and RSS also. And the thing is, again, he didn't pursue any RSS agenda, and most of the time he didn't dance to the tune of RSS. So he was not a favorite of RSS like many other political leaders in BJP. Now this Narendra Modi is coming in picture. This chapter covers Narendra Modi's rise in 2001 when he became chief minister due to the issues related to Chief Minister Keshubhai Patel. This chapter describes the Godhra train incidents and Gujarat riots and how he handled the Gujarat riots. And due to backlash of that, in fact, Vajpayee wanted to remove Modi. First in 2002 and then 2004, but both time he failed due to Modi's support of other party members. So another thing is that Vajpayee will take up the matter, pursue to a certain extent, but beyond certain stage he will not go, and he will follow the party line. This is what has happened two times. One time in 2002. And again in 2004. And here the ideology is changing. And in 2002, Modi openly asked vote for Hindu unity against the moderation of Vajpayee and Advani. And 2002 election showed that ideology alone can win votes, which Vajpayee and both Advani were not thinking earlier. So in 2004, after defeat of NDA government, that was the beginning, the end of the Vajpayee and Advani's Jugalbandi and the rise of Modi and Amit Shah's Jugalbandi. This is the conclusion. This photo is showing that after Modi's rise, Advani was put to the back benches. But as a show of solidarity or as a spectacle, Modi is still visiting Advani on his birthday regularly and cutting the cake, and these photos are being aired. So that kind of respect is there. May not be something real, but at least it is there in the public domain. So if we conclude the book, it's a political history. Why BJP wins through Jugalbandi of Vajpayee and Advani. There is a similar Jugalbandi between Mukherjee and Dindayal, and now Modi and Amit Shah. So there are three Jugalbandi is there. Why this Jugalbandi is so unique? That in a hierarchical society like India, this is unique, where there are two switches, not one. Vajpayee was the boss from 1968 to 1986. Then 1986 to 1995, Advani was boss and Vajpayee served under him. And there is another switch in 1995 where Vajpayee became the boss and Advani loyally served under him. And this is very unique in India, in a hierarchical society like India, where person tend to resign if suppose his junior takes over in any government job and any other political situation. This is quite unique, not only in India, all over the world. There is hardly any two switches in any Jugalbandi and in any political scenario. Another thing, because of this unity, BJP rarely splits like other party. Only major split took place in 1995, where Baghela took a lot of BJP MLAs to Khajuraho. And the main reason is, I think I'm finishing that ideology with teamwork and organizational unity wins the votes for BJP. Other parties have the ideologies, but their unity and other things which they are not able to pursue, and that they were not coming up. And this unity comes from history of Hindu nationalism, where it is seen that Hindu was defeated in major wars like Plassey, Panipat, etc. in the past due to lack of unity is Hindu. So they are always emphasizing on Hindu majority and Hindu vote bank. Hindu anxiety in early 80s and 90s due to Khalistan movement, rise of OBC reservation causing upper caste anxiety, that Saudi petrodollar is coming and converting Hindus into Muslim, so that's creating Hindu anxiety and class anxiety because of the reservation and other things. These are the things and which created the rise in Hindu anxiety. And BJP says that worshipping God by winning election is the this how they create the Hindu unity. And we know that BJP takes the elections very, very sincerely and seriously. Thank you very much. This the concludes. 45 minutes is too short for such an intense book. So this is the conclusion. Thank you very much. I think I maintained the time.
Oh yes, Rajiv, thank you for your wonderful effort in portraying the period in which BJP struggled, consolidated, and finally, you know, became a dominant party. Of course, the seeds were sown much earlier, post 1980. And, you know, of course, after the 2004 and especially after 2014, BJP, you know, is the most formidable party in India. And in fact, its dominance is felt, you know, all around. But how, you know, the building blocks of this particular ideology-based party were formed in the struggling years for nearly 40, 50 years post-independence is, you know, in a way, a tribute to the visionary leaders like Vajpayee and Advani ji, and they're complementing each other. But what one thing comes out very clearly is that the Indian political landscape changed 180 degrees post 1990, especially after the Riyadh Yatra and Babri Masjid.
Exactly.
And that was the time when there was some void in the Indian political system as Congress was declining.
Exactly.
The coalition parties or regional parties were coming to the fore.
Yeah.
The class struggles were also on the rise. So there was a space created during. So, and that space was filled by going back to the, you know, Hindu ideology plank.
BSP, Bahujan Samaj Party also tried to fill that gap, but they didn't
succeed. Yeah, but they were more on the basis of, you know, trying to garner the support of the people who are felt that they are neglected by the upper class and so on and so forth. But very adroitly, after 1992, and more particularly, of course, in recent years after 2014, ideology-based polity in India has come to stay, and there is a paradigm shift. In fact, it has started affecting the psyche and mindset of majority of the people. And now, you know, it's a different ball game. But be that as it may, I think the author has not covered, you know, the recent period. He has covered the period only primarily before Modi.
He mentioned that because he's a historian. Yeah. He says, yes. I need at least 15 years period gap between the event and the book.
Understandable. The history is still unfolding in the current times. So maybe after a couple of years, he will write an adjunct to his book. But excellent analysis and great presentation as expected of you, Rajiv. Unfortunately, not many people have been able to join due to the technical glitch, and therefore we don't have you know, any questions and views in the chat box. So
what happened? Actually, my I was getting phone also that they are not able to join or something.
Yeah. There is some technical bug which has entered due to, you know, the change of the platform, and my apologies to the book browser members that they have not been able to join. So in this particular review, you know, there is not much of attendance. And to that end, you know, I think the responsibility lies with me in not being able to configure this thing. So please pardon me for that. So on that note, anyway, once again, Rajiv, thank you for your this wonderful effort. Please keep involved in Baroda Book Browser's programs.
And, maybe we can review this book again.
Yeah, we'll look at it. Yeah, and thank you, Rajiv. All the best, have a nice remainder of the Sunday ahead. Thank you so much. But the members will be able to watch the whole review, the recorded version, once it is uploaded in next 2 days. So those who have missed out, they can always revisit the recorded version, which will be uploaded on YouTube at barodabookbrowsers.com. Until then, until we meet next time, stay safe, take care of yourself, and get yourself vaccinated.
But few my friends were able to join, in fact. I got some messages, but many were not able to join.
Correct. So anyway, but the effort was wonderful, and since now technology helps us to have a recorded version, so people can watch this review later on by visiting barodabookbrowsers.com on YouTube. On that note, until we meet next, this meeting is adjourned. Stay safe. Take care. Yeah. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thanks.